We do have food cooking downstairs, and there's plenty of it, so please stick around afterward for our communion meal together. This morning's lesson is going to be about that. We have not talked specifically about communion in about a year and a half, and so that seems long enough, so I thought we'd talk about it this morning, on what it is, why we do it, and what it's not a little bit. We have a whole section on our website about communion, in case you're interested in the teaching of grace on it. And so we do communion, a meal like this, two or three times a year. And so we dedicate a special time to have a communion meal in order to emphasize the doctrine of communion that we believe. Okay, and that's why we do that. And so this morning I want to talk about what it is and how we are joined together. That word communion has to do with a common union, or us coming together, united, to communicate a specific cause or message. All right, and that is what communion means. So this morning I want to talk about communion and fellowship, how they're related, and how it is that we're joined together. Okay, why are we doing what we're doing today? And before I get talking about that, I need to dispel some myths about it. As some of you have heard this before, but it's good to remind us of what we're not doing today in order to guard ourselves against falling into religion or ritual or practice without purpose. We need to talk about what it is not. Okay, because there's so much confusion in the world today. And I know we've got some younger people and things that are just come out here the last year and a half from the back as well. So it'll be helpful for us all to be on the same page in one mind. Communion is not that we eat. I know some of the younger kids may have this idea, and even adults have this idea, well, communion's where you eat the cracker, where you drink the grape juice or whatever. And they may think, well, communion's when we have food downstairs and we eat. That's not what we're talking about when we say communion. You eat at home every day. We gather together and eat different places. That is not necessarily what we're talking about. So it's not that we eat. In fact, communion is not even about the food, right? We'll see later, communion is a doctrine, not a dinner, all right? This begs the question, what is communion? What is it we're doing? And it really is about why we're eating. Yes, we're eating together, and that's one way we're practicing communion, but it's about why we're eating, not that we're eating, okay? And you'll see why this is later. So we're not just eating together. There are many religions who have food as part of their religious practices and their rituals. And so I want to dispel some of the things that we're not doing today. The first being the table of devils. We are not gathering around a devilish cause. This is a bad reason to meet. Of course, as Christians, you say that should be obvious, right? But if you're going to some place that teaches a wrong doctrine of God or a wrong gospel or some other religion, you are partaking of their religious ritual as part of their belief, their religious system. And even though we know that it won't affect our position and standing in Christ at all by grace, that is something Paul advises against for conscience' sake. In 1 Corinthians 10, he talks about the Corinthians who are eating meat offered to idols. All right? And the Corinthians knew that there are no idols. These are fake, false gods. Right? And it's good steak. Why shouldn't I eat it? And Paul says, maybe you ought to consider the weaker brother. Maybe you ought to consider not eating for the sake of conscience, not your own, because no man can judge your liberty in Christ, but for the sake of those who realize that that's meat offered to idol, and your presentation, your ministry ought not to be, let's eat meat offered to idols. That's not a good ministry to have. It should be, let's glorify the Lord. Let's do His will. Let's do Him service. So as much as you can, you see, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10, don't eat meat offered to idols. Don't be sitting at the table of devils, is how Paul says it. He says you can't eat at the Lord's table and the table of devils. You can't do that at the same time. It's self-contradictory, okay? And so some people call communion the Lord's table or the Lord's Supper. By the way, those three terms, communion, Lord's table, Lord's Supper, all only appear in Paul's epistles, which is interesting to think about, okay? We'll talk about that a little bit later and why it's important. And so we need to make a distinction between what we're doing and the table of devils. The reason why we meet is not because of the food that's on the table, which may be the same food they eat in the Muslim synagogue, or the Jewish synagogue, or the Buddhist temple. Maybe the same food, right? It's not about the food. Why are they eating it? That is more important than the actual food. And again, that plays into why we're eating today as well together. Also to flee from false gods. What we're also not doing is partaking of a Jewish Passover meal. Even though this seems more biblical, I mean, Israel is God's people in the Bible, and Passover was a holiday given to Israel. That is not what we're doing today. This is not Passover literally, and it's not Passover symbolically. It's not a replacement Passover. It's nothing like that. Okay. Under the law in Exodus chapter 12, verse 43 and 48, it says only the circumcised could eat the Passover. The Passover was a required meal, a holiday, not just a meal, but a whole day and a ceremonies and rituals they had to perform. If you did not do the things under the law that under Passover that said you had to do them, then you were breaking the law and thus sinning against God. Right? Breaking God's law, breaking his covenant means that under his law program, you would have been the recipient of God's curses. Right? We understand this does not apply to us not being under the law. Okay? In fact, none of Israel's holidays are binding on us. Right? It's not because we hate holidays. It's not because it's so devilish that they do it. It's simply because that was Israel's law and not given to us to perform. You see, our message is the cross of Christ and not Jewish Passover. And thus, we're told not to do these things. Okay? So only the circumcised could eat Passover. It was required annual holy day in Exodus 13. And Colossians 2:16, if you're in Colossians, Paul teaches us that those things in the Old Testament, the holidays especially, as well as the temple sacrifices and everything else, were shadows. Now, it was real meat that they were eating back there, but the ceremony, the meaning of it was simply a shadow. You know, the Jews ate the Passover to remember their deliverance from Egypt, right? And as Christians, don't we know that actually Jesus fulfills the Passover when he came and offered himself as the lamb on the Passover day 2,000 years ago? Jesus fulfilling Israel's holy day of Passover, okay? And so Passover got a new meaning for Israel, which was no longer their deliverance from Egypt, but their deliverance from sin in Jesus Christ, right? New meaning to Passover. That's not what we're doing today, okay? We're not observing the Jewish Passover. But in Colossians 2:16, Paul says, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink in respect of a holy day or of the new moon or the Sabbath days. There were required things to eat and to drink and special days and special weeks, moons and months. And Paul says, don't let anyone tell you if you don't observe this special day, this special meat, this special drink, then you're not complete in Christ. You're missing something. You don't have God's grace imparted to you. Because in this very chapter, Colossians 2:10, Paul says, you are complete in him who is the head of all principality and power. He is the head of all authority. He's the head over all the church. And you're complete in him. There's nothing you lack in Christ, right? It's all about who you know, the world says, and you are known of the Lord. You're a member of his body. And so no man can judge you regarding what you eat or drink or special days or special months or any of Israel's laws. Colossians 2:17 says, these are a shadow of things to come. Okay, they are a shadow. A shadow is what falls behind or is not the clear image of the real thing, right? Your shadow is not yourself, right? You are yourself. So a shadow is simply the reflection, the shade of what the real thing is. And the real thing is something to come. Do you see that in the verse? So the shadow, which was in the Old Testament, the shadow, which is Israel's law, was a shadow of what? It's not a shadow of you, okay? It's not a shadow of the mystery of Christ. It's a shadow of things to come. When Christ returns in his kingdom glory, it says in Ezekiel and Isaiah that he'll come back and establish his kingdom with Israel, and once again, they'll be his chosen nation, and it says at that time, they will observe their holy days in remembrance every year. And the world will come and observe them with them. And they'll have this New Testament celebration according to their holy day schedule. All of them, of course, pointing to Christ, right? And they'll do that in religious observance to glorify Christ as King of Israel, as the Lord of the earth, right? That's not mystery information. That's prophecy information. That's not concerning you, okay? So we can appreciate and learn that information about how it's fulfilled in Christ in the future. But the shadow of things to come is not the body of Christ. It says here, the body is of Christ. There are shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. You and I, who are members of one body, we are of Jesus Christ himself. Okay? And so, the Jewish Passover is not something that we're doing today. We're also not doing Jesus' Passover. So you'll say, well, we're not under the Old Testament. We understand that. We don't follow the Old Testament Passover meal rule. But Jesus came in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. He instituted a new day, a new ordinance, a new sacrament, right? But actually, if you go back to Luke chapter 22, we'll see a couple of verses here. What Jesus was eating was not a new thing in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And this is where understanding the special revelation given to Paul is important, because if you think that instructions for the church are found in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you will be keeping Jesus' Passover. Not only that, but you'll be selling everything you had and keeping all the commandments of Israel, because that's what Jesus taught them, to keep all the commandments of Israel. In Luke 22, verse 1, we see here evidence of Jesus keeping the Passover when it says, "The feast of unleavened bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover, and the chief priests and scribes sought how they might kill him, for they feared the people." Satan entered Judas Iscariot in verse 3, and later Jesus sends Peter and John in verse 8, in verse 7 and 8, to go and prepare us the Passover that we may eat. In verse 8, you see that? Jesus said, go and prepare the Passover, right? That's not what we're doing here. It's not prepare the Passover so that we can eat together. But that's what they're going to do this night in Luke 22. Galatians 4:4 says, Jesus was made of a woman born under the law. Jesus lived every day of his life under the law on earth. Okay, and he obeyed the law. That means the law of the Passover. All right. We see down in verse Luke 22, verse 13. After he tells them where to find the room, he says, they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready, what? Passover. What did they eat in that room that night? The Passover. Okay, and you be clear about that. Jesus was not saying, and now since I'm here, the church has begun, and we're going to do a new thing called the Lord's table and, you know, do that. He says the Passover, that's what they're eating. And that's an Old Testament instruction. Jesus, of course, gives something new at that Passover meal. And something new, by the way, was not the bread and it was not the cup. Those were part of the Passover meal, along with the bitter herbs and other things on that plate, right? But what he did different is when he took the bread and broke it, which again was not something new, we'll see later. Breaking bread was something they did at the Passover meal. When he broke the bread, then he said, take, eat, this is my body. That was new because that's not what the bread meant in the Old Testament. The unleavened bread was a symbol of their living in the wilderness, not having ovens to bake leavened bread. And so they lived and were delivered out of Egypt in the wilderness and they could not bake leavened bread. It was unleavened bread. So it was to remind them of this wilderness wandering back in the Old Testament. Well, Jesus says, this is my body. This should remind you of me now. So the Passover should now remind us of you? Yeah, that's the New Testament fulfillment of the Old Testament shadow, right? Jesus is their broken bread, right? Not the Old Testament unleavened bread. But this is not something we're celebrating. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 8, Jesus talks about, the author of Hebrews here talks about Jesus in his relationship to Israel's New Testament. When Jesus came, he came to be a sacrifice for Israel. He came to be that final sacrifice for Israel. He came to be a sacrifice for Israel so that their Old Testament would be replaced by the New Testament. Hebrews 9, verse 8. We see here that it says that the Holy Ghost signified by the Old Testament shadows and figures that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which is a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience. Hebrews describes in detail how the Old Testament could never provide what God had promised Israel. It couldn't do it. Even if they offered sacrifices, they had to do them every year, and their sacrifices, continual sacrifice, could not provide the forgiveness and salvation God had promised. They needed a better sacrifice. A one-time sacrifice. And that's why Jesus came to be the lamb for Israel, their sacrifice. Okay. Down in verse 11, Christ being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us, the us there being the Hebrews. And it goes on to describe Christ's blood in verse 14 and verse 15. It says, for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For where a testament is, there must also necessity be the death of the testator. And so we've drawn, I don't know how many times, the dispensational chart where we have Christ's death, and we have Matthew chapter 1, and Mark chapter 1, and Luke chapter 1, which is Jesus' earthly ministry here. And Galatians 4 tells us he was born and lived under the law, under the Old Testament. And it's wrong to think that the New Testament began here. It did not. Because in Matthew chapter 26 and in Luke chapter 22, when they ate that Passover, Jesus says, my body and blood is going to bring that New Testament. And Hebrews 9 says you can't have a testament unless the testator dies. This is the earliest the New Testament could begin, is when Christ shed his blood for it. Okay? This is telling. That means all of this information is Old Testament. It's under the Old Testament time period. This is why he told the healed leper to go offer a sacrifice. This is why he told him to obey the law and everything else. Okay? But we already know that, having studied the Bible rightly divided before. Look at Hebrews chapter 8. Jesus is the mediator of the New Testament. And what Christian doesn't think that they're a New Testament Christian? Well, I don't. That's the kind of Christian. most of them do. In fact, I have something on the website that was titled, I am not a New Testament Christian. And I got some response to that one, which I was looking for, just because sometimes you got to show people clearly what you're saying. I am not a New Testament Christian. And what they read in that was that I'm not a Christian. That's what they read. That's not what I said at all. I'm not a New Testament Christian. There's no such thing in a scripture. There's a New Testament given to Israel, not to us. I know that because of Hebrews chapter 8, which is a quote of Jeremiah 31, but Hebrews is in the New Testament portion, so I think it gives us a little more credibility on interpretation here. The author of Hebrews writes that in verse 7, if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. The first covenant was Moses' old covenant. The second is this new and better covenant, new better testament. In verse 8, it says, for finding fault with them, he saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the church of Christ. No, with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. He doesn't say, I'll make a new covenant with the Baptist and the Methodist. He doesn't say that. He says the house of Israel, house of Judah. Right? The new covenant was for Israel because they're the ones that received the old one. Think about that for a moment. If you're a Gentile who never had a covenant with God, you weren't at Mount Sinai with Israel as a Gentile. I mean, obviously, personally, you weren't. But even as a Gentile, you weren't. You had no representation there. Israel had that old covenant with God. Then how can you ever have a new covenant when you never had one to begin with? Right? It's not something that you can have. You can't have a second one if you didn't have a first one. By the way, if we're on the topic, and this may be ringing some bells for people, you can't be born again unless you were born the first time. Right? And Jesus wasn't talking about you being born in your mother's womb. He's talking about Israel being born in Exodus 4:22. Israel needed to be born again. You just need to be made new. Right? There's a difference there. That's another lesson for another day. But Hebrews tells us, written to Hebrews, by the way, that the old covenant could not do what was needed to fulfill Israel's promises. The new covenant was promised to Israel, and Jesus' death fulfills the new covenant for who? Israel. The old covenant was God telling Israel, be good and I'll bless you, be bad and I'll curse you. The lesson learned that we ought to learn also, the lesson learned is that there's no way they can do that. There's no way man can do good when God just says, do it. Right? We can't. Right? We're sinners. Breaking the law once requires a punishment. And even when you do get break the law in the Old Testament, you offered a sacrifice, but that sacrifice doesn't pay for your sin. It's an animal. And you offered another one the next year. So that proves it didn't pay for your sin because you're paying for it again next year. Right? But the Old Covenant had no power to help Israel become the blessed people of God. The New Covenant, however, wasn't just God telling Israel to do things. It was God telling Israel to do things, and then he says, I'll give you my spirit to cause you to do them. I'll help you by giving you my son, Jesus Christ, and my spirit in you. The difference between the Old and New Testament wasn't the audience. The Old Testament was to Israel, the New Testament's to Israel. It wasn't the law. The Old Testament was a law, the New Testament was the law written in their hearts. The difference was that the New Testament is given the spirit for them to cause them to keep God's statutes. Ezekiel 37, verse 26. Okay. So Jesus came when he said, take, eat, this is my body, and this cup is the New Testament in my blood. What we're seeing here is a new thing happening for Israel. Okay? And that's what Jesus talks about. Jesus does not speak at all about the cross in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. People call it the Lord's Supper there in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which the Bible doesn't. Lord's Supper is a term Paul uses in 1 Corinthians 11. Okay? Jesus calls it the Passover. And then he adds this thing of the New Testament to the Passover, telling the 12 disciples to remember me and my death when you eat together from now on. Right? But those disciples that he was talking to in the room, first of all, you would not have been welcomed there. Think about this. You would not have been welcomed. You say, well, I'm not one of the 12 apostles. Forget that. Because you're a Gentile, you wouldn't have been welcomed there. You know, Jesus wasn't sent to Gentiles. The 12 apostles were 12 apostles over the 12 tribes of Israel. You would not have been welcomed at the so-called Last Supper. That's something to ponder. Why not? Right? Would you not be welcomed in Christ's church today? Of course you are if you know the gospel, right? But you wouldn't have been welcomed there. That's why we're not doing that downstairs. This is a different issue. This is a different thing going on that night here in Matthew 26 and Luke 22. Okay? The disciples in that room, even if you could get in, did not understand the very gospel that saves you today. Look at John chapter 20. And no doubt we'll deal more with this as Easter comes up this spring. But John 20 is after Jesus' death, after Jesus' resurrection. John 20, right here. And so we know this is after they ate that Passover meal and after Jesus said, I am the sacrifice for the New Testament in my blood and body. Okay. And in John 20, verse 1 and 2, the first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early when it was yet dark. By the way, that means it's not a sunrise service, right? Because Christ's resurrection happened while it was yet dark. Mary Magdalene was there before the sun rose, right? And the stone was taken away from the sepulcher. In verse 2, then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple, whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulcher, and we know not where they have laid him. Read that slowly to yourself in verse 2. Mary Magdalene thought someone stole the body of Jesus. She did not believe he was resurrected. She was coming to check on the body. The body was gone. She says, who took it? This is not a believer in the resurrection. Now, Mary Magdalene was a believer in Jesus, no doubt. That's why she was coming to be with the body. And it wasn't that she was negligent. She believed what Jesus taught in his earthly ministry. But Jesus never taught anyone to trust his death and resurrection to save them. He never taught that in his earthly ministry. That was revealed to Paul later. And so they believed he was Jesus. And that's why they were sad, because he was the king and now he's dead. And they go to his tomb to honor him, to consult the body. And where's the body? Right? They don't know what they're going to do now because the king's dead. Okay, in John 20, drop down to verse 8. After Peter and John have a foot race to the tomb and John wins, in verse 8, it says, then went in also the other disciple which came first to the sepulcher. That's how I know John won. John writes in here that Peter and John ran to the sepulcher and Peter went in, but it says that John got there first. But then it says, which came first to the sepulcher, and he saw and believed. Okay, you say, believed what? Well, verse 9 says, for as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. They were not believing in resurrection. They had believed Mary. You're right, Mary. Someone did take the body. When she said someone took the body, they said, unbelievable. There was a big stone in front of that thing. No one took it. They went there, they ran in, they saw the clothes. They go, you're right. Someone took it. These guys didn't know. They didn't know until Jesus appeared to them. And even then, they were stunned, didn't know, until Jesus asked for honeycomb. So, anyway, my point simply being is that they did not preach the cross. And so, if what we're doing downstairs is this, we shouldn't talk about the cross. Jesus didn't. Not for salvation. And perhaps we don't even have to believe in resurrection. They didn't. The disciples ate of it, and they didn't. You see, I'm trying to explain to you the order of events here, that we're not doing this. We need some more information than what they had that night. Okay. And by the way, people call it the Last Supper. We came to this church building some 10 years ago, maybe 9 years ago. And on the wall right over here, I think it's still down in the closet downstairs. We took it down. Was one of those pictures of the Last Supper. You ever seen these? Michelangelo, or was it Leonardo? Leonardo, I think, did it. Right. The picture of the Last Supper. The Da Vinci Code was all about this and how the guy on the right was a woman and this sort of thing. The Last Supper. You ever wonder why they call it the Last Supper? Anybody have an idea? Look at Mark chapter 12, verse 45. You know this is a trick question, right? Because I'm asking and you're going, and is it obvious? He died after that. Yeah, I get that. He had the supper and then he died. But we do know that Jesus, this is the last time he ate. So what are you talking about? Not only did he drink vinegar on the cross, but you don't really call that a meal. Mark 12, verse 45. There's no Mark 12, 45. Got you on that one, didn't I? Oh, 14, 25, thank you. Mark 14, 25. During that Passover meal they were eating, after he said, take, eat, this is my body, and he says, drink, this is my blood, the New Testament, which is shed for many. Verse 24, by the way, is that Calvinist verse there. He shed for many. Why isn't it shed for all? Paul says it's shed for all. But here in Mark 12, 14, 24, Jesus says, this is my blood, which is shed for many. He shed his blood for Israel. But verse 25 says, verily, truly, I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until that day that I drink it new in the kingdom of God. Everything Jesus taught at that night had nothing to do with the mystery of Christ, nothing to do with the gospel of grace. It had everything to do with Israel's kingdom and the new covenant given to Israel. And he says, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine. Well, they drank in that cup, right? The fruit of the vine, grape. Until I drink it new in the kingdom of God. And so he's saying, this is it, the last time I'm drinking Passover, right? Well, if you turn to, I don't know, Luke 24, 42, you see that when Jesus resurrected from the dead, so he ate here, cup and bread and some fish and other things. In Luke 24, which is over here, Jesus, in verse 42, ate broiled fish and honeycomb. I love this verse. I was thinking about this verse. You ever thought about whether you're going to eat in heaven? If you ever thought about that, set your fears at ease. You will. So you say, I hope so. I mean, it's not heaven if you're not eating, right? But Luke 24, 42 says, they gave him a piece of broiled fish and honeycomb. This was his resurrected body, by the way. I mean, he was glorified. He died, rose from the dead, and he goes, look, I'm not an apparition here. And he starts gnawing on some fish, right? I wonder what fish tastes like in a resurrected body. I don't know. But Jesus ate it. And so that's comfort to me, that when I get a resurrected body, I can still chomp down on something. Jesus did it. It's going to be tasty, I think. Anyway, my point here simply being, Jesus ate something here, right? Honeycomb and fish. You say, well, it wasn't a real meal. It was just like a little snack because he had to prove that he was a real person. Well, look at John 20. John 21, rather. John 21 is an interesting little story because it's the last time we read in the book of John of his appearing to his disciples. John 21, this is after Jesus ascended, or after he resurrected, rather, and he tells his disciples what to do, and he says, you know, I'm going to send you like Christ, like the Lord sent me, like God sent me. And after he disappears, what's Peter's first idea? Let's go preach. You know, his first idea is, let's go fishing. Peter, what a guy. John 21, in verse 13, Jesus, they're fishing out in the sea there, and they see Jesus on the beach, on the shore. And they see him there, he's cooking. And he says, bring your fish, which by the way, he tells them where to get it, and we're going to cook something. In John 21, 13, Jesus comes and takes bread and gives them, and fish likewise. And this is the third time Jesus showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, do you love me? And there's the story about him asking Peter three times whether he loves him or not. Jesus ate with them. He ate here too. The Last Supper? I don't think so. He ate here. He ate here. What's the deal? Of course, this is not unusual for tradition to get things wrong. And of course, probably they're talking about the Last Supper before he died and that sort of thing. But it was not his Last Supper, the thing that he ate. It was the last time he drank the fruit of the vine until the kingdom. But the kingdom has nothing to do with us today. So why would the church today drink the fruit of the vine and eat the bread? Are we living in the kingdom? There is a connection in people's theology, you see. They think we're living in the kingdom. They think we're bringing in the kingdom. And Christ said things about eating in the kingdom. That's what we're doing. No, that's not what we're doing. Okay. Let's move on from this. It's not Jesus' Passover. It's not the Jewish Passover. It's neither the Catholic Mass. A lot of people are turned off by the religion of Catholicism, and rightly so. A works-based system filled with extra-biblical traditions and rituals. This is not what we're doing. Sometimes people call it the Eucharist or the blessing, right? We are not teaching the magic cracker and drinking people's blood. Okay, even though vampires are a famous thing through Catholic history, we do not drink Jesus' blood. Even though Jesus said in John 6, you have to drink my blood or you won't have eternal life. I know he said that. But in that same chapter in John 6, 35, he says, drinking my blood is following me. That's what it is. Okay. If you're ever talking to a Catholic, and according to John 6, there's two things to bring up. One, John 6 is not talking about anything to do with communion or the Lord's Supper. He's talking about I have eternal life. And secondly, John 6, 35 gives you the key to interpreting why Jesus said, eat me and you'll live. John 6, 35 says, I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger. He that believeth on me shall never thirst. Hunger equals coming to Jesus. Quenching thirst equals believing in Jesus, right? Are you thirsty? Believe in me and you won't be thirsty. Are you hungry? Come to me and you won't be hungry. So then he says, eat me. What do you think he's meaning? Come to me. Believe in me. Why would he mean anything else? That was the beginning of his message. I am the bread of life. If you come to me, you won't hunger. If you believe in me, you won't thirst. Therefore, eat me, drink me. The Catholics say, oh, eat you. Okay, we'll do that. And they teach that the cracker turns into Jesus. And they totally missed his point. You see? They say, I know some Catholics and they believe in Jesus. Well, fine and good, right? Teaching the gospel of the grace of God, by the way, which is not taught in John 6. But they believe in Jesus, they come to Jesus, then yeah, they are doing what Jesus said, but they got that whole thing wrong about trying to eat his flesh. The Roman Catholic Church, by the way, does teach quite literally that if you do not eat the transubstantiated cracker, you do not have eternal life. That is in their catechism. Okay? They get life from the Mass. There's a religious difference in Roman Catholicism based on what we believe by the gospel of grace of God. Okay? So they may be good-intentioned people, nice people. They may even love the Lord, but loving the Lord is not the gospel, right? And so we're not teaching a magic cracker downstairs. I don't say a prayer, and suddenly the soup and bread downstairs turns into somehow Jesus' actual flesh. Neither is the soup downstairs representative of Jesus in that way. This is ridiculous. Okay, we're not teaching that sort of thing. John 6:63, after many people left Jesus' following because it was a hard saying that they had to eat him. By the way, it wasn't a hard saying because they thought, I'm not going to eat someone's flesh. That's going too far. That's how the Catholics interpret it. They say people left Jesus after he said this because they thought, we're not going to drink your blood. We're not vampires. No, they understood what he was saying. Jesus was teaching that unless you come through me, you won't be saved. That was their offense. They said, you're just a man. You're not the way. That was why they were offended. That was the hard saying. How can we come through you? Okay. It wasn't because Jesus said, suck on my blood vein. And anyway, John 6:63, Jesus at the end of his message here explains to his disciples that it is the spirit that quickens. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, they are life. The words, the flesh profits nothing. Paul says something similar in 1 Corinthians 8, where he says meat and drink, it means nothing. The kingdom of God is not in meat and drink, Romans 14:17. Okay? Eating something does not get you saved. Not eating something does not take away or diminish your spiritual blessings in Christ. We'll cover that later. But Jesus says in John 6:63 that it's the spirit. He wasn't even talking about his flesh. So we're not doing the Catholic Mass downstairs. Okay. In 1 Corinthians 8, by the way, that's the verse I quoted. I think I misquoted it. Let me read it to you here. It says, meat commends us not to God, for neither if we eat are we the better, neither if we eat not are we the worse. This is why I said at the beginning, it's not that we're eating that we're having communion. It's why we're eating. Okay? If it was that we're eating, then that means that you're here today and going to eat food with us. Somehow you're imparted some special blessing, and that is false. 1 Corinthians 8, verse 8 said, meat commends us not to God. Neither if we eat are we better. If we eat not, are we worse. You see that? So you cannot eat downstairs with us, and you're not worse off in Christ. You can eat with us downstairs. You're not better off in Christ. So what are we doing? You see? But you see, this gets to the heart of why some people go to church. A lot of people go to church in order to get something from God. And if I say, you're not getting anything new from God that you don't already have, they're going to go, well, why am I doing it? Right? If I say, if you put money in our box in the back, you're not going to get a special blessing like you did under the tithing system. Oh, why am I giving money? You see, people do things to get from God. That's religion. Grace is not like that. Under grace, you don't do things to get from God. God has given you everything that you need by his grace. Grace is giving you what you don't deserve. Right? And if he's done the finished work and his grace is complete and you're complete in him, there's nothing else that he needs to give you. The only thing that needs to happen is, as we said this morning, is you to walk in the knowledge of it. And this is why, by the way, we do what we do, right? To participate together in God's grace. Moving on here, what we do downstairs is not the Protestant ordinance. You say, I'm not a Catholic, I'm a Protestant, or I'm a non-Catholic, right? And you may hear in some churches to say that in the Old Testament there were hundreds of laws, but in the New Testament, wrong already, okay? We're under the New Testament, we're under the mystery of Christ in this dispensation. They say there are two ordinances. God has given us two ordinances. And what are they? Everyone knows? Baptism and the Lord's Supper. Right? It's interesting. Where do you find what they define as baptism and the Lord's Supper? Baptism in Matthew 3, Lord's Supper in Matthew 26, right? When did Jesus live? Under the Old Testament. How is this anything to do with? Not to mention water baptisms were part of Israel's law in Exodus and Deuteronomy. They're nothing new in Matthew 3. John the Baptist wasn't doing a new thing there. He was doing it in a new place. But anyway, that's a lesson for another day. Colossians 2:14, doesn't Colossians 2 tell us that the ordinances that were against us were nailed to the cross? You say, oh yes, but these ordinances are not hard. There's only two of them. But if you don't get baptized, water baptized specifically, do you have the same standing as every other member of your church? And they'll say, no. You'd be baptized to be a member of the church, right? Can't vote unless you're baptized, right? Can't be in the choir unless you're baptized. You can tithe, but you can't vote and be in the choir unless you're baptized. And so isn't that against us? You can go to a Baptist church and they will not allow you to do certain things until you're water baptized their way, by the way, because there's different ways to be baptized. If you're baptized their way, then somehow you have access to things you didn't have before in Christ. So doesn't that mean that's something between you and the Lord? This is the dilemma. The theologians debate this, and they go around in circles about this. But it's very easy. We understand God's grace. No, it's not required, and nothing separates you from the love of God, and you have all spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus in heavenly places, and so, yeah, water baptism does nothing for you. And if you say that, you get kicked out of Baptist churches, right? Because it means something to them, you see. In the same way, I can say eating food doesn't do anything for you. We don't do the little cracker and juice anyway, you know, which is a remnant of the Middle Ages where there were so many people coming to Catholic Mass that they didn't have enough money to buy everyone a meal. And so they divided it up into the small things, and everyone partake of the Mass that gives eternal life. That's a grace to the poor people, right? We can't buy them all meals, but we can give them a little cracker and juice and a little wafer, right? How pitiful, right? But anyway, that's another story for another day. Christ died to remove the ordinances that were against us. There are no ordinances that were required to perform to receive spiritual blessing from God in this dispensation. Okay. Mark 16:16 says, baptism was required. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Every Church of Christ elder will tell you that. And they're right. Mark 16:16, they're both in the verse, folks. You have to believe and be baptized to be saved. Acts 2:38, the gospel Peter preached to Israel when they were pricked in their heart, and they said, what shall we do? He said, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins in the name of Jesus Christ, and you'll receive the Holy Ghost. Well, do you receive the Holy Ghost if you're not water baptized? I don't know how many denominations, including one of the largest ones, Assemblies of God, will tell you you do not receive the Holy Ghost until you're water baptized, and they'll add another baptism to that, the fire baptism, the Holy Ghost baptism, right? So you can believe the gospel, apparently, whatever gospel it is they teach, and you're missing these things. You're missing the signs that follow. You're missing the water baptism putting you into the church. You're missing the Holy Ghost fire. So you can believe the gospel and be missing these things. That's the wrong gospel, right? The gospel we preach is of grace. Grace means what God gives you that you didn't work for, didn't deserve. And God's grace has given you all spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus. You're not lacking identity with Christ. You're not lacking the Holy Spirit, which was given you the moment you believed, Ephesians 1:13. You're not lacking identity into the church. You are the church, and you're baptized into it when you believe the gospel. You see? So there's something right wrong with Protestant ordinances as well. Okay? It's interesting. Protestants like to say that the Lord's Supper, the Lord's table, is a sacrament, sacramental grace, or a means of grace. And this is why they do it so ceremoniously, because there's something special about the ceremony we're doing today to impart special grace to you. And so it seems kind of sacrilege for me to say that you have all God's grace right now, whether we eat or not, right? Well, you're not going to stay for dinner, will you? Right? Why would you stay for dinner if I tell you you got everything now? It smells good. I get that. But you see, the Protestants who teach a sacramental grace, a means of grace, are robbing you of Christ's riches. Okay? You have the riches of Christ, the riches of God's grace through Jesus Christ and his blood, his finished work, not through any sort of meal that you eat or cracker or ordinance. This brings up a question then. Why in the world are we eating at all? Right? Some people say, well, let's get rid of all of it. Right? We do nothing. People ask me, do you do the Lord's Supper? And I know why they're asking that, Because no one asks me that unless they don't, really. Right? But they ask me, do you do the Lord's Supper? And I say, yeah, we do the Lord's Supper. We do communion. We have communion, is why I say it. We have communion. Okay? But why do we do that? The scripture tells the church to meet together, to eat together, to sing together, to minister together, to work together. There's lots of things we do together, right? And one of them is eating. And it's not required for you to have a position in Christ. It's just part of what we do together. As we'll see in a moment, there's something exemplified by eating together. The Bible calls it breaking bread. In fact, that's what Jesus did that night when he took the bread and he broke it, right? This phrase, breaking bread, appears in scripture. Look at Lamentations 4. You heard me right. Lamentations 4. I'm using my tabs on this one. It may not even be in my tabs. Lamentations 4. I'll give you an extra second. It's a skinny book in between Jeremiah and Ezekiel. So if you found Jeremiah, go to the right. It's like two pages in between there. Jeremiah is the second largest book in your Bible. Lamentations chapter 4, verse 4. This is the first time you find in the Bible this reference to breaking bread. And it's not in the New Testament. It's not in the Lord's Supper. It's not in the ordinance that Christ gave the church. It's Lamentations 4, 4. It says, the tongue of the sucking child cleaves to the roof of his mouth. Of course, Lamentations is written by Jeremiah looking at the destruction that God had poured out in Jerusalem for their disobedience. That's the context. Lamentations 4, the tongue of the sucking child cleaves to the roof of his mouth. Why? He's thirsty. He has nothing to drink. Right? This is judgment poured out on Israel. The young children ask bread, and no man breaketh it unto them. That's a weird way to talk. We don't talk like that, it seems like. But that's breaking bread. And it's saying here the opposite, that this child wants bread, and no man breaks it unto him. Well, why does there need to be a man to break it unto him? Why can't he get his own bread? Right? Because breaking bread requires two parties. Okay? You say, well, I crumble my bread up on my chili, you know. No, that's not it. Breaking bread requires two people, and you have one loaf, you break it open. Have you ever seen a loaf of bread? It's got the crust on the outside, the inside soft, right? You break it, and there's two people. You break it, you have one person, one half, you got the other half. This is the breaking bread concept. It requires more than one person. It requires two people. And they do it together, eating the bread. Here, the child wants bread. There's no one that can break bread unto him, and a child can't get his own bread. He's a child, right? This is crucial, what this breaking bread means, because people turn this concept of breaking bread into a religious ritual, and it's not. It's two people eating together. Look at Luke chapter 24, verse 29. Here's Jesus appearing on the road to Emmaus. Remember Emmaus Road, when after Jesus died, his disciples are moping about because they don't know why he died. And then Jesus kind of walks with some of them as a stranger kind of on the road to Emmaus, and he starts talking with them, and they don't recognize who he is. Well, they don't recognize him, and he's saying, why are you so glum? And they say, well, we had this Messiah, and he died, and it's just only been a few days since this. And it's getting kind of late. In Luke 24, 29, it says, as they drew nigh to the village, they constrained him. They don't know who he is. This is a stranger they're talking to, saying, abide with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in, he being Jesus, went in and tarried with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, that's dinner, right? He took bread, blessed it, and brake, and gave it to them, and their eyes were open when they saw him do that, because they saw him do that before, right? But the point here I'm trying to make is they were having dinner. He wasn't there saying, and now let's all join hands in transubstantiation. It wasn't the sacrament and means of grace Jesus was imparting here. He says, they said to him, come on in, we'll have dinner, it's getting late. He went in, he took the bread, he broke it in order to have dinner. They were breaking bread. That's how they did that. But when they saw him do that, it reminded them of when they ate before, right? I'm trying to show you what breaking bread means. Luke 29, 35, after they realized it was the Lord, they testified to Simon Peter that the Lord is risen indeed. In verse 35, they told what things were done in the way and how he was known of them in breaking of bread when they ate together. Acts 2, verse 46. I'm trying to get some definition here of what breaking bread means. Acts 2, 46 says that the believers at Pentecost had all things in common. All things in common. Okay? You thought sharing clothes with your sibling was bad. They had all things in common. All right? and sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. They sold everything they had, and they continued daily with one accord. Where did they continue daily? In the temple. Do you need Israel's temple at all to continue walking the Christian life today? Answer, no, you are the temple. They were not going into the temple and saying, guys, this temple's nothing. You are the temple. They didn't teach that. That temple meant something to them. Okay? Which tells us the message they were preaching in Acts 2 was not the message we're preaching today, according to the gospel of the grace of God. But Acts 2, verse 46, they continued in the temple, breaking bread from house to house. Now, either they're going from house to house, having a ceremony, okay, imparting the means of grace to people, or they're eating together from house to house. You decide, right? I'm trying to show you here the definition in the Bible of breaking bread is simply two people eating together. You do it with someone else, okay? Look at Acts chapter 20, verse 7. You'll like this story. You'll sympathize with it. Acts 20, verse 7. Upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together, that's one of the few verses in the scripture where we learn of when the churches met and how they met and what they did. On the first day of the week, the disciples came together to break bread. Some people read that and say, well, that's where they came together to have the communion, the Lord's Supper, the Lord's table, where the priest sanctifies the bread and then they get special blessing. And is that what they're doing? Or the disciples come together to eat because they're traveling from different places and they need to eat and they're eating together because they have a communion together. We'll learn what that is here in a moment. But it says, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued his speech. So he's going to leave the next day. But he's preaching so long, he's preaching until midnight. Some of you are looking at your watches now going, almost there. There were many lights in the upper chamber where they were gathered together, and there sat in a window a certain young man named Eutychus, being fallen into a deep sleep. And as Paul was long preaching, you see, that's my pattern there. Paul is my pattern, folks. I'm just telling you. Okay. As Paul was long preaching, he sunk down with sleep and fell down from the third loft and was taken up dead. What a story. The preacher preached so long, the guy in the window fell down dead. Wow. That's some powerful preaching, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't because he was slain in the spirit, like in Acts 4, it was because he was preaching too long. But in verse 10, Paul went down and fell on him and embraced him, said, trouble not yourselves, his life is in him. I think he's praying at that point, right? First person dying on his sermon. When he therefore was come up again, Paul rose him from the dead and had broken bread and eaten and talked a long while, they departed. He departed. Now you tell me, what happened here? Eutychus fall down dead, and then Paul goes, all right, he's resurrected, let's have mass. Let's, ushers, get the cups of grape juice. Is that what's going on? Or is it, he resurrects him, and they say, let's eat. And they give him food. Are you okay? Here's some food. Maybe you're starving. And they feed the guy. It says he ate. What's your point here, Justin, about breaking bread and eating? I'm simply trying to make the point here that when the Bible talks about breaking bread, when it talks about Jesus broke bread that night, it's talking about eating together. And this is crucial to our understanding of communion in the church, because communion in the church is us doing things together, because our identities are shared together, right? And so when we eat, it's not that we eat as we eat today separately. Normally on a Sunday, we won't have a meal together. We'll just kind of go home, and everyone eats what they want. Sometimes some of us get together and have a meal at that restaurant, some over there. But today we're doing it together to display the doctrine that we believe, that we are united in Christ Jesus. We gather together for the same reason. We sing together for the same reason. We work together for the same reason. And we eat together to show that we are members one of another in Christ Jesus. Okay, it's just a way to practice that out. Okay. This happens in other areas of your life, by the way. This isn't a foreign concept. This is not some sort of pious, holy type of mystical type of ritual or anything like that. It's not that at all. You do this in other areas of your life to show fellowship. Consider family reunions, right? Anybody have family reunions or just my family? You have reunions? What do you do at family reunions? Do you eat? Why do you eat? Eat and say, you eat because this shows solidarity. We're eating this meal because we're all the same family. Because it's kind of an echo of what you do in your own house, right? Anybody have family dinners at your own house? You might have dinner tables. Okay, are you people who still use dinner tables? Some people don't use dinner tables. Right? A dinner table was designed, a long table, so that the whole family can sit around it. Why? Why did the family all eat together? Why don't they just eat in their separate rooms? Say, sometimes we do that, yeah. But why do you eat all together? It's to show solidarity. We are one family. We're one family, we eat together. Right? OK, Family reunion. We're a large one family. We have a reunion. We eat together, right? What memorial services? Sometimes they have memorials of certain people, and if you're to remember some person or some cause, they'll gather together to have a fundraiser. And all the times these fundraisers, they're always sitting in me these fundraiser advertisements, and they say, $500 a plate. A plate? It's an expensive plate, right? But why are they uniting together around food? It's because of the party principle, right? We have a like mind in politics or whatever it is, and you know we need the funds, and we'll give you food. Food is constantly, eating together is constantly bringing people together for certain causes. Not all the time, but it is used for that way. Because when you share food, you're partaking together of something that helps you live. It's the same mind, right? This is the principle. Okay, this is why people do that. You need to eat to live, and we live for what? This principle, this doctrine, this political party, this family, whatever it is, and we eat together, right? It's naturally you do this. There's no difference in the church. Okay, it's not some sort of religious ritual. It's that we come together in the name of Jesus Christ, doing his will in this dispensation, and so we eat together. And our eating together today is for that purpose, which means that if you're not a part of that work, if you're not saved, then why are you here? Not that we don't love you. Be saved, right? Paul says that. He says, examine yourself. Be saved. But what we're doing here is communion of the body of Christ. Okay, we're coming together in unity, okay? Communion is a doctrine, not a dinner. The dinner simply displays the doctrine. Sometimes you know how people were raised by the manners they show you at dinner. Anybody experience this? Right? The same thing, okay? Same thing with eating together in the church. A doctrine is communion. Communion is doctrine. It's not the food. But when we eat, what does it do when we eat together? It shows how the doctrine is working in us. Say, what does grace doctrine do with eating? Or are you breaking bread with someone, or are you just hoarding your own bread? Because if you're not breaking bread with someone, if you're not eating together with someone, if you're not helping provide the food for everyone, if you're not here eating together with the same mind, then you're here deceptively, subversively. You're here disagreeing with the doctrine, and you're saying, I'm going to eat together with you, but I don't really, I'm not in union with you. You know what you call that? Devilish, deceptive, a lie, right? And thus communion is closed, right? Communion is closed to the body of Christ. Our ministry is open to all, but you can't receive the benefits of Christ. You can't be a part of the church unless you believe the gospel, unless you're saved. Right? See, it's not the whole world that's saved. The whole world can be, but they're not. Look at Ephesians 3, verse 9. Or look at 2 Corinthians 6. I want to show you a connection here between communion, this word communion, which, by the way, is only shows up in Paul's epistles in 1 and 2 Corinthians. It's never mentioned, communion's never mentioned, that word, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Okay? Nor the practice, I would tell you. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, we see a definition here, which is interesting, talking here about separation. But notice the words that he uses. You can use the Bible as your dictionary in these cases like this. When he says, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? Now an unequal yoke, a yoke is bringing people together, right? They're connected, they're tied together. And so he says, don't be connected with certain people. Then he says, what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? Righteousness and unrighteousness are different. They cannot be yoked, right? So you should be yoked, have fellowship with, connected to righteousness, right? The next line. What communion hath light with darkness? What commonality? How is light and darkness united? You can't have light and darkness united. You're either light or you're dark. You can't be both. You say, there's either light or there's dark. There's no communion with light and darkness. What communion ought you to have? Well, with the doctrine of light, but here also with the believers is what it's talking about. What concord hath Christ with Belial? What part hath he that believes with an infidel? So you see, there's four words here that are used interchangeably. Fellowship, communion, concord, part, partaking, participation, right? What does communion mean? Fellowship, concord, union, partaking. Communion is you partaking together. But what are we partaking of? You say, food. You're missing the point. We don't partake of food together. You can do that anywhere. We're partaking of Christ together. And we're eating. That's what communion is. Communion is you partaking of Christ together, and we're eating together for that reason. Okay? Fellowship is not a verb. Christians are fond of changing definitions of words. Christians think that worship is singing, and it's not. It's your service. You know, people think the church is a building, and it's not. It's the people. People think fellowship is a verb. It's something you do, right? You know, we're fellowshipping. What? And by that, they mean hanging out, I guess. There's church, and then there's fellowship, right? Church is where we do church stuff. Fellowship is where we do non-church stuff. That's totally wrong. Fellowship is what you have with God. Concord, communion, a part. Ephesians 3:9, our ministry is to do what? To make all men see the fellowship of the mystery. What's it talking about? Our union, our concord, our participation together with Christ. That's the doctrine. That's the doctrine we're supposed to preach. That's why communion is a Pauline doctrine, Pauline teaching. Because we teach, how many bodies are there in the church? One. How many gospels are there in the church? One. How many times did Christ die? Once. There's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one body. We're all one in the body of Christ, members together. And having fellowship and communion is the doctrine that teaches that. Okay? And we eat together. You see, I'm adding that on there at the end there, that it's not the food, it's the doctrine. When we believe the gospel, we are joined together in one body. Ephesians 1:13 says that when you heard the gospel of your salvation, you trusted it and you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And 1 Corinthians 12:13 says, by one Spirit are you baptized into one body. Okay? Turn to 1 Corinthians 10. 1 Corinthians 10, 16 and 17 are the verses here that talk about communion. Paul says, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of what? It's the communion of the blood of Christ. He says, the bread which we break, is it not the communion of the what? The body of Christ. They're breaking bread, they're drinking of a cup. People want to make the import about the cup and the bread. Wrong emphasis. The emphasis is on the blood and the body. That's the emphasis. Because in verse 17 it says, we being many are one bread and one body. You're not literal bread. You are the body of Christ. We are all partakers of that one bread. We have a fellowship in Christ, a communion in Christ, members of Christ. You're each one partaking of all spiritual blessings in Christ. Right? This is something to rejoice in, something to celebrate in. Paul says in Philippians 1, verse 5, that he thanks God upon every remembrance of you. This is the top of your outline there. He thanks God upon every remembrance of you. Anyone ever seen that on the back of a Hallmark card or something? Hallmark doesn't do verses anymore. Some Christian card, Dayspring or something. But why does Paul thank them upon every remembrance? For your fellowship in the gospel. You see, the fellowship is not something that's outside the gospel. The fellowship is in the gospel. How do we have communion? By believing the gospel. Okay. Philippians 2 verse 1 says that there is any fellowship of the Spirit. How do we have communion? Because we have the Holy Spirit dwelling in us. The Holy Spirit dwells in you, know you not? He dwells in me, he dwells in you, he dwells in all you that believe. We have fellowship in the Spirit. Fellowship in the blood of Christ. 1 Corinthians 1 verse 9 says that God has called us into the fellowship of his dear Son, of Jesus Christ our Lord. We have communion, why? Because we have the same Lord. We are Christians because we've been put into the body of Christ. We have the same gospel, same Lord, same baptism into Christ. We have the like mind. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 9 and 10. Communion is the ultimate unity doctrine. And the unity is around the gospel, the doctrine, how you teach Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 1:9 says, God, whom you are, is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together. What is communion? Things joined together, concord. Be joined together in the same mind and the same judgment. We're not joined together because we're eating out of the same bowl downstairs. We're not joined together because we're all drinking the same grape juice. We're joined together because of Jesus Christ, and because we have the same mind and the same judgment. This is why, unfortunately, we can't have communion with Catholics. We don't have the same mind and the same judgment. You see, we can't have communion with everyone if we have different minds. Paul says, have the same mind. And then he goes on to teach about doctrine. Right? Our fellowship is around the mystery of Christ, around the Spirit in us, around the right doctrine. So communion is partaking together. It's not about the meal. okay? It's about partaking of Christ and his cross. You say, I've done that. Then great, you're part of the body of Christ. You say, I understand the mystery of Christ and who I am in the Lord. Well, great, then we have this in common. We have the same mind and can rejoice in the Lord, and therefore we can work together, we can do ministry together, we can sing together, we can learn together, we can eat together, right? And so that's the idea of having a meal with communion. So what we eat doesn't change. Understand that. I'm going to pray here in a moment. It's not in order to bless the food so that the chemicals somehow give you a spiritual blessing. It's nothing like that. The food downstairs doesn't represent what you have in Christ. The bountiful blessings you have in the Lord are represented downstairs. You know, what if you don't like the food? You know, it'd be a bad representation. It's not that at all. We're simply eating together because we are members together in the body of Christ. That's it. That's communion. Okay. And where you do that, you're having communion. If you're doing it for the purpose of having the same mind. You say, I had communion last night with my family. Great. But some families aren't so united, right? Some people aren't that united, and so you can't have communion with them. So that's the difference. That's what it is. Any questions, any comments? Anything burnt downstairs? Lord, we thank you for this teaching of communion that though we did not have the same mind, you've given us your word to study and to know and to learn, that we can understand your gospel. And praise to you, Lord, that you saved us by your death. And as we meet together, the only reason why we have things in common is because of your death, because of your resurrection. We thank you for your blood. We thank you for this new creature called the body of Christ, by which we are united together. We thank you for knitting ourselves together as we provide food for each other. And so many people here have done that. And as we talk with each other and encourage each other, we understand we're members of each other. Help us to better appreciate that we are in the party that will graduate to glory together, and that we'll be able to worship you for eternity. Lord, we thank you for your grace. Amen.